Bisa sih, Bang. Ini pasti kerekam kan ya? Stop.
Apa?
Udah jalan sih, Bang, recording.
Bisa ya? Oke.
Bisa, bisa.
Ya udah berarti di kamu ya.
Ya.
Kita nunggu sebentar lagi, mungkin 10.07 ya. Saya kasih 2 menit lagi deh, buat siap-siap. And also don't forget to pin yourself out ya sama Andreas. Jadi pin orang ya, biar dia muncul sebagai main actor. Okay, I think should we proceed? I will move you as the host. I think, apa ya? This will be better. Okay. Very good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and also my beloved students from International Law Subject H or H. Today it is the last sessions of the brown bag discussions made or organized by the Philip J.G. Submoot Court participants in the 2021. We have the such a wonderful and fruitful discussions regarding the some topics under the international law that will be delivered by Payah as well as Andreas as one of as not one of both of them are the participants of Philip J.G. Submoot Court in international round or global round next year. So he will speak about two issues, one about the air and also the outer space law under the international law, as well as the diplomatic and consular law under the international law itself. So it takes approximately one hour. Suaranya udah kedengar belum, Pak ya? Sorry, tadi keputus kayak.
Iya, keputus, Bang.
Halo.
Halo.
Bisa dengar?
Iya, Bang, bisa dengar,
bisa,
Bang.
Bisa, bisa. Bisa, bisa, Pak.
Halo, bisa dengar suara saya, Pak? Ya?
Bisa, Bang. Halo, Bang. Kedengeran, Bang.
Bisa dengar, ya?
Bisa, Bang.
Oke, kita mulai ya. Should we proceed? I hope that the... but I don't know. Weather situation. So, well, good, very good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and also my beloved. Pak, ya? Halo, keputus-putus.
Putus-putus, Bang.
Oke, coba kita tunggu sebentar lagi ya, ya. Mungkin sinyal ini ya.
Oke, Bang.
Sekarang aman nggak?
Aman sih.
Soalnya kalau hujan kayaknya sering kayak gitu dia. Dia ups and down, up and down. Mungkin kita mulai aja. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Very good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And also my beloved students from the International Law Class H. Today is the final sessions of the brown bag discussions met and or organized by the Philip J. G. Submoot Court participant in 2021. Today we have two presenters will discuss and will present their thought and their perspective regarding some issues in international law, particularly about the airspace and outer space under the international law, as well as the diplomatic and the consular under the international law itself. Which we have two speakers, which name is Andreas as well as Paita. They will speak in the 20 minutes for the presentations for each of you, and then we go to the question and answer sessions. But before we proceed this event, I will show you the videos first. Enjoy the video.
Ah!
Well, welcome to the brown bag discussions. Brown bag discussions terminology means that it is the unofficial or informal meetings and informal discussions between two or more groups to discuss some topics that related to their subject or that related to their patient itself. So today we have Paiah as well as Andreas. They will talk about some issues or some topic about the international law and also the mode problem of the GSAP 2021. So without further ado, I will please Paiah first for the first speaker or first presenter for the 20 minutes ahead is yours. So I offer the microphone and also the share screen.
Thank you, Bang. Share screen first. Okay. Bang, suara aku kedengeran kan? Do you hear my voice?
Yes, Bang? I can hear your voice clearly and your presentation is also so good.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Morning, guys. I'm Fahia Oktrina, one of delegates from Philip CG Sub Moot Court Competition in 20 and 21. So today, I'm going to represent my lecture. Our lecturer, Bang Ariu, to discuss about international air law. But before, precisely before I bring this topic, I'm very thankful for this opportunity to have a discourse today with you guys. So to shorten the time, we move to the next line. This is an outline of our courses today. There is first terms of international air law. The secondly, there is sources of airspace law. Third, principles of airspace law. Fourth, study case of Bawean incident relating airspace law. And the last one is mode problem of Philip CG Sub under airspace law. So the first, there is two terms in international air law that very, very well known that you must know, guys. There is two. The first is airspace and outer space. Airspace itself is a space where state has regulates of their country in its territorial and feels sovereign over the air. And the outer space itself is only used to denote outer space, or we call it antariksa, in the sense that space where the gravity of the earth no longer applies and there is no air anymore so that flying ships cannot fly in space. This is outer space terms is just found very new when the United Nations Assembly Resolution in 1962 adopted in 1963 and entitled the Declaration of Legal Principle Governing the Activities of States in the Exploration and Use of Outer Space lays down a series of applicable legal principles, which include the provisions that outer space and celestial bodies were free for exploration and use by all states on a basis of equality and in accordance with international law. So that is the difference between airspace and outer space terms. And we move to the next line. There is the definition of what is airspace law and outer space law. Airspace law is all specific legal norms regarding aviation, aircraft in space in its role as elements necessary for flight. This is under AUTORIS and GTLACOR. And outer space law is an area of law that regulates the activities of state governments and international law in outer space. This is under Harsono book in page 341. So we can conclude airspace and outer space law, they are governed by two different laws. So in this discussion, I will only focus to discuss about the airspace law. So we move out from outer space law. Next chapter, there is sources of airspace law. There's a Paris Convention in 1919. This is about flight agreement signed October 13, 1919 by 27 countries. And on that Article 1, It means explain about the full of exclusive sovereignty of this of the countries on that space above its land and sea areas. Why we have Paris Convention while we have Chicago Convention? So there's a history in this Paris Convention. This is begun where the invention of the means of air transportation dates back to 1783 when pilot Thierry Derozier launched the first hot air balloon flight in Paris, which 2 months later was followed by the Montgolfier brothers' first attempt human-driven hot air balloon flight. Then in 1785, Jean-Pierre Blanchard, along with his American counterpart John Jeffries, took what he is considered the first step in a long-haul flight using a hot air balloon. So on this era, on the next era, French was made the hot air balloon again and entry the Dutch territorial airspace, Dutch territorial, and it's a Dutch field assume that a threat of sovereign of their state. So this why the that's a story why Paris Convention was born. And on that time, there's a Roman adagium. It said to jus est solum et jus est quo et colum et in feros, which means that the state exercises its right to a Hague where it still has effective control over its airspace. And that adagium still apply until now. And but this Paris Convention really have a weaken. So many late ratification with many countries because several conditions, especially in Article 2 and Article 5, you can see on Article 2, you can see it clearly. It means a party that's not joining this convention, their territory are can be used by another state who ratification this convention without permission to the state who's not signed this convention. So this is a tantamount like erosion of sovereignty of the state. And on the Article 5, too, this means no contracting state shall, except by a special and temporary authorization, permit the flight above its territory of an aircraft which does not possess the nationality of a contracting state. This means which country, being a member of the convention, has the power to arrange or restrict flights without permission to another country who's not a member of this convention. So that's why Paris Convention assume with many countries not compatible to use regarding the civil aviation. So that's why there's a renewal of Paris Convention named Chicago Convention in 1944. There's a convention at that time, and after this convention, there is amendment again in Montreal, exactly in 1984. It's about Article 3 bis on Chicago Convention, and after that, met the 96 articles, special rights on the obligation of all participating countries. So we move to the principles of airspace law. The first, there's a principle of airspace sovereignty. This about supreme authority of the state. This arranged in Paris Convention and emphasized again in Chicago Convention in Article 1 about sovereignty over its airspace. Because the international law really protects the state sovereignty, as well as to lands beneath it. And like the judge in the International Court of Justice, in the case of Nicaragua, they said principles of respect for state sovereignty. There is a dividing line and state sovereignty under the ground and in the air column above it. So if there is a state wanna entry the another territorial airspace, they have to have a permission first before they entry airspace of another countries, because it's an it's
bayangnya. Halo.
Keputus, Bang. Wait.
Yes, please continue.
Okay. And there is a principle of airspace jurisdiction. It's about if there's a crime or violation in an aircraft, the country whose registers the aircraft itself should be responsible for their wrongful act. This arranged in Chapter 2 of Tokyo Convention 1963, especially in Article 3 and Article 4. It's arranged there. And the third is principle of responsibility. There are three systems named Warsaw, Rome, and Guatemala systems, and divided into five. And divide it into five again of these principles of responsibility. The first, there is presumption of liability, which means the defendant of the case is assumed always responsible for their act until they can prove that they're not innocent or guilty. And the secondly, there's presumption of non-liability. This is the opposite of the first principle. This is where the defendant not always responsibility depends on the treat first. For instance, like when passenger on the aircraft bring the cargo or baggage, it's responsibility of the passenger, not the responsibility of the aviation. And third, there is absolute liability. This means every act of the party can be held to accountable based on without questioning there are due the negligence or an error, just absolute liability. The fourth, there is liability based on fault. This means a party must be accountable legally if there is a wrongful act of their act. And the last one is limitation of liability. This principle about restrictions about of the responsibility, but still have based on the legally regulations. The fourth, we move to the study case. This is in Indonesia. There's a Bawen incident in 3rd July 2003, when Air Force Indonesian Army intercept a foreign aircraft of United States. As you can see, this incident began when United States Navy, Air Force of United States, we called it U.S. Navy, sailed from Singapore to Australia from Karimata Strait and then entered the sea, the Java Sea, especially in Bawean Island. At that time, the United States Air Force was do their routine flight drills and performs dangerous maneuvers for civilian aviation traffic in Indonesian airspace. In the many expert said actually the United States has a permission to the Indonesian authority first, but they do beyond the agreed time, and therefore it was considered the threat sovereignty of Indonesian airspace. So at the time, the daily exercise was finally stopped, and the United States moves away from Indonesian air territory. In that Bawean incident, there's a violation of, especially in the Chicago Convention Article 6. This means every act or schedule of air have to be operated to the authorizations of its state. So the another state can anytime do their practice or anything in the another airspace country, because it's same of threat of sovereignty of the state in airspace. And the secondly, there is principle of airspace sovereignty. This is the important principle in the airspace, because like land and sea areas, airspace is also really important. Sorry. For instance, like ensuring flight safety, one of the sources of state income, protecting citizens from attacks by other countries, and means of bargaining value in international agreements. And we move to another chapter. There is relate to mood problem Philip C. Jessup court competition under airspace. There's a state named Apapuya. They have a civil aircraft named Maintain Airways. They fly without permission on that airspace territory to the vital city in the Apapuya. And because Apapuya assumed that a threat of international violations, they shut down that their civil aircraft itself, and the pilot and the passenger was died on that civil aircraft near capital city of Apapuya itself. We can assume that a self-defense of the Apapuya itself, but we must consider the another convention or regulations in international law, like the Kellogg-Briand Pact, one of East Cogens. Indirectly command us not use of weapons in any situations, because this principle has an impact on civil aviation to the extent that the state may not use armed force against a commercial aircraft. And on the Article 3 Chicago Convention 1944, it said the contracting state recognized that every state must refrain from resorting to the use of weapons against civil aircraft in flight. So this is endangered of act of Apapuya to their civil aircraft, and principle of protection that was said from International Civil Aviation Organization. They said condemns all acts of violence which might be directed against aircraft, air crews, and passengers. So Apapuya indirectly has violated international law as United Nations Security Council resolution. They said to condemn use of weapons too. The International Court of Justice said elementary considerations of humanity even more exciting in peace than in a war. So there is a point of this violate of human rights too. So to shorten the time, the conclusion of this meeting, it's to conclude, airspace law is a law that arrange everything in the air, and if there's a state wanna go or entry the territory of another country, they have to get a permission first before they entry the airspace, because this is there's an under nations itself. If there's a state not under the regulation, it's a tantamount of violate international law, international airspace law. Okay, maybe that's all for me. I'll end up this discussion, and the next material going to discuss with my partner Andreas Wira. Okay, thank you guys.
Okay, thank you so much for your comprehensive presentations and discussions. We will move forward for the next discussions. The topics about, or we're talking about the issue of diplomatic and consular under the international law. I think this is the new topic for our class because we never talk about these issues before. So without further ado, Andreas will peel onion some topics or some issues regarding the diplomatic and consular issues. 20 minutes ahead is yours, Andreas. So I offer the microphone and also the share screen. Feel free to use.
Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your attention and thank you for your opportunity, Sir Ariwira Dinata. It's my pleasure to present and discuss about diplomatic and consular relation. First, I will share screen about diplomatic and consular. All right. This is the diplomatic and consular relation. In international and in the world, this is the important thing if we want to have a good relation to another country. But first, before we know about, before we so far discuss about the diplomatic and consular relation, first thing we must know definition diplomatic and consular. In the definition, we can know about the principle and what the duty, what the function of the diplomatic and consular. Diplomatic and consular is the same purpose, but in the different function. And to the privilege, also the diplomatic and consular have a privilege when they have been in the received country. Three, and concerning Philip Jessup. All right, before we talking about so far about diplomatic and consular relation, first thing we must know the definition of what is the diplomatic, what is the consular. Diplomatic and consular is the important thing if you want to discuss and if I want to make good relation to another country. For example, Indonesia and Singapore, if Indonesia have another business or everything about politics and regulation or law, they can use a diplomatic to make the good, to strengthen relation. The meaning of strengthen relation is we have a good teamwork and good cooperation with another country. We can see in every country in the world, we can see in, for example, in Jakarta, we can see every diplomatic office and in an diplomatic office, but consular is the different one. So what's the different thing about diplomatic and consular? Diplomatic is the opening of diplomatic relation is also an effort concerted activity is expected to improve the welfare of the people in both countries. So the meaning of diplomatic is to effort concerted activities to strengthen relation and cooperation. Same purpose, diplomatic and consular. The purpose is to strengthen relation. But in the different function is very, very so different. Diplomatic is generally we know as the political regulation, or it can be representative as from the another country. We can conclude this diplomatic. It can be mean we open a good relation to make a good teamwork, so we can. Make sure that our cooperation and our teamwork is going well. And consular is representative or also known as non-political representative. Yes, it's not a political representative. For example, consular is generally the function generally in for example in economic business or in the private private business. For example, if we can see in Bali have too many travels and too many travels tourism. So they saw another country which want to protect or to make sure that interest or concern about their citizen in Bali, they must make a consular office and go to make a consular in. Diplomatic always in place is in the capital. In the capital near government, because they want to have another business about the government, about the politics, so they place it into the capital city. And the consular is the different one. Consular, if you read on you can see my slide, was working areas basically covered the province of the receiving country. It's belong to area and territory, territory, it can be province, to in that country. So it's the different one. All right, the function of the diplomatic. We can see the protecting, negotiating, ascertaining, and promoting. We can see this the function in the Vienna Convention, according about diplomatic relation. But before we talk so far about the diplomatic and consular, if the state or the country want to make relation, they must have a mutual consent. It can be called as principle of mutual consent. Or before they make the mutual consent, as we see in Article 2 Vienna Convention, they must have a good faith. What the purpose they want to make a relation to another country. And not only that, not only mutual principle, they must see about the reciprocity principle. If the country give a good privilege in the receiving country, so our country must give the same like that to make a same privilege to receive it our country. All right. What the meaning of representing? The meaning of representing is the sending state in the receiving state. We have representing is our country in our sovereign in another country first. Protecting is to protect our national interest. To protect the citizen or everything about our citizen and about nationality and interesting. Negotiating with the government and the receiving state. Yes, this is the function of diplomatic. We must have a diplomatic. The meaning of negotiating is how can we negotiation to the government about our interest country. For example, if Indonesia have another business about the politics, about the law in Singapore, they can communicate from the diplomatic and as representing from our country is Indonesia. Ascertaining by all lawful means, condition, and development in the receiving state, and reporting thereon to government of the sending state. So, ascertaining, the diplomatic is the function to report the situation in that country, what the situation of the citizen in the receiving country, and reporting to sending country. All right, and then the promoting. Yes, diplomatic is can symbolize as the promoting friendly relation. Yeah, if we have the diplomatic relation to another country, it can be we promoted that we have a good teamwork, a good relation to the receiving country, so we can grow up together. All right, classification of diplomatic. The classification that ambassador or mission accredited to head of state and other heads of mission of the of invoice minister and internationals accredited to head of state and that of charge the affairs accredited to minister for foreign affairs. So based on the Article 20, Vienna Convention about diplomatic relations, based on Article 29, Vienna Convention, the person of a diplomatic agent shall be inviolable. He shall not be liable to any form arrest or detention. The receiving state shall treat him with due respect and shall take all appropriate steps to prevent any attack on his person, freedom, or dignity. And then two, freedom to move and travel, freedom from tax and exercise. Four, and freedom from jurisdiction, or we can say the immunity. So the diplomatic can be jurisdicted in the receiving country. So this is the function of the consular. Consular responsive have the main task of respecting of fighting of the interest of the nation. Yes, they fighting about our interest nation. For example, if in consular in another country, in consular Indonesia in another country, they must fighting about our interest nation. Then on the state and protecting our interests and their citizen and legal entities through the consular relation with the receiving country, including enhancing economy. Yeah, this is so far the main function of the consular relation is to enhance economy, social and cultural relation in the working area of the receiving country. So this is a classification about consular posts. The consular general, consul, vice consul, and consular agent. Article 9, paragraph 1. Yes, the privilege. Yeah, the privilege is same like a diplomatic, but the difference is in the jurisdiction. Jurisdiction is not extensive as diplomatic responsibility. The privilege, first thing, the immunity. Yes, what I said, the jurisdiction, the consular is not extensive, not so extensive as the diplomatic representative. But in this in the same diplomatic privilege is the right to communicate freely with nation of the sending country. Yes, we have the consular have right to communicate freely with national of sending country. They freely to communicate everything it is in the country. Three, immunity to official document and receive. Yeah, document and archive. Archive is immunity and be protected, so don't worry, it can be safe. And the word, the right to be extended from the responsibility for committing a crime until the time where exequatur is revoked of the position of the consul is replaced by another. So it is related in our case, Philip Jessop competition in 2021. This discuss is very extensive, but I will talk discuss according our about our topic about diplomatic and consular relation. The case is very similar with our situation is the COVID-19, but in the our developed GSAP, it can be called as JVID-18. The first one from the April make NBL because of the pandemic of the JVID-18. April make NBL. NBL is a company which in health company which want to make a vaccine about this virus. JVID-18 pandemic and all employees were required to sign and time their hiring a non-disclosure agreement. So every employee which working in a NBL company, they must make a non-disclosure agreement. And if that apropulia, run of say in the different ways. If apropulia make a company, Ranof Sayo make an entry regulation. Entry regulation, whom every country have indicated as a high-risk country by the Ranof Sayo criteria, country according to the regulation can enter the country. So every country has symbolic or as in tag as a high-risk country, they can enter the Ranof Sayo. The first problem is begin from now. Ms. Foreman, employee from NBL, created information about NBL company. They created information that NBL company hiding two secret that the two employee in NBL has indicated as JVID-18. They told it in from the Twitter. They published in the public, and because of what Mr. Foreman do. Apropulia police catch Mr. Farman in the house, but Mr. Farman run away to the Ranof Sayo consular and Ranof Sayo consular and ask for the asylum. But because of order from the consular and the government, they received the Mr. Farman and consider her as the asylum, and then And then allowing her to remain at the consulate for the time being until it can be clarified whether she was under criminal investigation and if so, what happens. In this case, because they run away from the police to the consular office, Aprepulia make discussion that they were waiting about news about the Mr. Farman by clarifying her as the criminal investigation. After that, on 6 June 2018, because of what information from the Mr. Farman, Ranustayo of announced of its website that Aprepulia has added the list of hiding country according because Aprepulia hiding information about the two hiding employee that indicated as Jeffit acting in hiding country according introduction from the Ranustayo, and because Aprepulia tag as a high risk country, Aprepulia lost 80% of tourists in Aprepulia, including nearly all those participating in group tours left the country. So it make Aprepulia lost economic so far. And then because of that, Ranustayo recall all non-essential diplomat and consular, and it declared Ranustayo not want to make a relation to Aprepulia because they recall all non-essential diplomats and consular officer from Aprepulia, leaving only 5 at the embassy in Buton and 2 at the consulate in Segura province. And then Aprepulia prosecutor office formally charged Mr. Farman with the offense under the National Penal Code, causing public disorder, violation government, non-disclosure agreement, interference with our police investigation. And then Aprepulia from the Ministry of Foreigns deliver a not verbal to Ranustayo embassy that Ranustayo violated international law by make Aprepulia as the high risk country and is the Ranustayo surrender Ms. Farman to domestic authority as criminal. Aprepulia asks to Ranustayo that they must surrender the Mr. Farman, and state that Ranustayo is violated international law by not do as the order from the Vienna Convention. Or international law according about diplomatic and consular and about refuge. But Ranustayo responded that not verbal, that Ranustayo did not violate international law. By receiving Mr. Farman, Ranustayo said they didn't because they have any concern, they have the right to protect Mr. Farman and refuse to surrender Mr. Farman to Aprepulia. All right, so it's our opinion about as applicant Aprepulia, the action that was took by Ranustayo is granting asylum to Mr. Farman is violate international law. Why violate international law? Because Ranustayo violate international law in accordance with Article 55, Paragraph 1 and Paragraph 2. I can conclude that in the Article 55, Paragraph 1 and 2, it said every consular or diplomatic must respect and must honor every regulation and the law in the receiving country. So the Aprepulia have stated that Ranustayo violated international law by not respecting their own law and regulation. They also have a duty not to interfere in international affairs. Yes, in this case, Ranustayo is not have right to interfere internal affairs of the state. And we can see in Article 55, Paragraph 2, Vienna Convention on Consular Relations is that the consular premise shall not be used in any manner incompatible with the exercise of consular function. Clearly, Ranustayo indeed violate that international agreement and therefore shall be expect Mr. Farman in the first Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. Because Ms. Farman, as the employee of NBL, bricked up about disclosure agreement, Aprepulia said the Mr. Farman is the criminal because they tell the truth and the secret in the NBL company according from non-disclosure agreement. So what's about as a respondent, Ranaf Stayo? Mr. Kramer Farman as Asylum did not comment extraordinary is a formal process whereby states grant each other mutual jurisdiction in criminal matters on the basis of bilateral or multilateral or on horse basis. Consider on the convention of protocol relating of the status of refuge at on Article 33, paragraph 2 about prohibition of expulsion of or return of refoulement to the people who commit serious crime and extraordinary crime. The people who commit extraordinary crime must extradite to the origin state and predominant political motivation or be disproportionate to end claimant political objective. Particularly cruel action may be considered serious non-political crimes due to being disproportionate to an alleged political objective. Terrorist acts which are characterized by their violence towards civilian population, even if committed with the proportionate political objective, fall to be regarded as serious crimes. Ranaf Stayo have said that they have no right to extradition because Mr. Farman is the political criminal. And we can see in a refuge convention in Article 1, paragraph 2, there is a criteria what can be a criminal. We can criminal. But because of Mr. Farman tell the truth, they can be set as a criminal and it's not right to have any extradition. And then as Ranaf Stayo have state two, Ranaf Stayo consistent to the international law. The international in reference that the protection of human beings by many means of international, including consular protection, resort to the international human rights treaty and mechanism, diplomatic protection, and so on is today one of the principal goals of the international legal order. And then when the protection of foreign national and is an issue, diplomatic protection, which in the remedy with the longest history and has a proven record of effectiveness, is an obvious redress to which states should be given us consideration. So the conclusion is diplomatic and consular have same purpose, but a different function. Diplomatic generally have mission and duty which are concerned in political, or not only political, in law and regulation, and consular in non-political. From the case, we can conclusion because the case is very even the diplomatic and consular have sent some of privilege, but we know that diplomatic and consular must respect every regulation and law in receiving country. Thank you for your attention. This is my presentation. Thank you for attention. If you have any question, you can ask.
Am I accepted to ask some question, Bang Wira?
Yeah, you can ask your question.
Okay, thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah.
Today, I think today we have a really interesting topic. First of all, we discussed about the airspace law, and now we discuss about diplomatic and consular law. And in this opportunity, I want to ask you, Bang Wira, about diplomatic immunity. As we know that in the article number 31 in Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations on 1961, told us about a diplomatic agent shall enjoy immunity from the criminal jurisdiction of the receiving state. He shall also enjoy immunity from its civil and administrative jurisdiction. And we know that this article just gave any diplomats in this world often consider that diplomatic immunity inherent in them is an opportunity given to act arbitrarily regardless of the rules and regulation that apply. For example, many human trafficking just spread around the world, then we know that this case is really happened. So my question is about what do you think about this privilege of diplomatic agent, about this diplomatic immunity? I think you can understand my question. Thank you for the opportunity.
About diplomatic immunity, I have, thank you for your question. I will answer according about in Article 31, about the immunity, about the immunity of the diplomat. Yeah, it's in my opinion, because this is the treaty, because this is a treaty and international law, because as a symbol to respective.
Okay, so, Andres, maybe you can answer the question directly.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I want to answer a question from the Saramutia. All right, and in my opinion about the immunity, is we can explain it extensive because it's because in the every case it because in every case immunity means the immunity is to protect diplomatic and consular relations. So in my opinion, is because every consular or diplomatic have right to immune from the judicial or everything about jurisdiction of from the receiving country. But if the consular and diplomatic violate international law, yeah, they can be jurisdiction, but they make the country is they make this, but they show the in the world that the country is very very bad in moral and in moral because of that. So we must be careful. Because of diplomatic and consular have immunity or immunity in the jurisdiction from the jurisdiction, but if they did that for any reason for another interesting or not reason that we can the word accept it, if they do that, they show to the world that the. They make the country that have not moral and not do as the international law. This is my opinion about your question. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for your opinion.
I'm going to answer the question from Vero Sanjaya. They asked about what the legal basis of boundaries of airspace of the states. Regarding the case of Benin and Niger in the International Court of Justice, the judge said the dividing line and the state sovereignty under the law, ground, and in the air column above it. This means the sovereign of state has their sovereignty only on their airspace, can only be measured on their airspace above its land and its sea. So if there's a tip of sea and the land, then that's it's a tip of the airspace too of the country. And the legal basis, it's on Article 1 Chicago Convention in 1944. It's about sovereignty of the states. Another again, it's on Montevideo Convention, and the next question from Sela Wadania: relations between international Chicago Convention and national law? Chicago Convention, it's one of the sources of international law to arrange the subject of international law, which means one of the subject is the country. So every act of the national, of the state on the domestic airspace, it must honor the international law sources and prohibit to out of the line of boundaries of international law. Which means this case is Chicago Convention. For instance, if there is a state wanna make their national regulations about airspace, example like travel restrictions, they have to make sure that another country not get the loss of their regulations. The first step must consider first about their national law or domestic law, because this is arranged under the international law especially in this airspace, it's arranged in Chicago Convention 1944. I think that's enough, Bang.
I think your microphone is off, right?
Okay, I think that's enough.
Oh.
Am I my voice? You can hear my voice?
Yes, yes, I can got you very clearly.
Okay.
Okay, if you have any questions for the speaker or for the presenter, just raise your hand by use the raise button of picture, or also you can turn your microphone on if you wanted to ask him or her directly, or you can also use the chat box picture to ask your questions by write your questions down there, and the questions will be answered by the two speakers itself. Any another questions from you guys? First of all, I'm so sorry because this the heavy rainy coming up in the Bengkulu, so my signal is not good at all. So sometimes there is the technical difficulties here happen. Another questions? If there is no, so we go to the last session. It is the conclusion. So I will give 2 minutes to of the speaker to wrap up the materials or the topics. Maybe we should begin with Andreas first and then closing by the Paia. To Andreas, the time is yours. Thank you.
The conclusion about meeting today, discussing about diplomatic and consular law is the most important thing in the every state in every country in the world. Why? Because we in this world we cannot rise alone. We need another country to make grow up. So we need this diplomatic and the consular regulation to make a good friends to good friends or to good make good relation to another country. But we because diplomatic for the political interest or concern, and consular from the private business or everything about to protecting and many more. We can see together. And but because of we have a diplomat because diplomatic and consular have a many immunity about privilege. It can be means that not respect law and regulation. We must respect every law and every regulation in the receiving country. This is my conclusion about this discussion today.
Okay, mana Paya, the microphone is yours.
Okay, the conclusion of my courses today about international air law, especially in airspace law, that airspace law it's arrange everything in the air, so if there is a state wanna entry the territory of another state, they have to get permission first of the other nations itself. Because if there is no permission, it will assume as the threaten of sovereignty of another state. So if there is a state not under the regulations too, it means the tantamount of violate international airspace law. Maybe that's it, Bang.
Okay, thank you so much for your wrap-up conclusions. I think this is the final sessions of this event. Thank you so much for joining and participate in this brownback discussions. And we really eager your support for our team. I mean that the Faculty of Law team and also the Universitas Bengkulu team and also the Indonesian team, because we will compete with around 600 universities from all over the world. I mean that according to the data of the GSAP or International Law Student Associations in the DC, Washington DC, say that there are 90 countries all over the world join this competition. So we need that you support actually from the participants and also from the students in the Faculty of Law Universitas Bengkulu. Again and again, thank you so much for the sharing. And also wish you luck for your final exam for all of you, and also wish you luck for the team. Thank you, and you can go out from this room Zoom.
Thank you, Bang. See you.
Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you for having me, everyone.
It's my pleasure.